one way that you experience God and God's loving support with you, then you're welcome to come here and just have some meditative work. Okay, I think that's, oh, one last thing here that I'm aware of. The gifts with the vision catalog, you can trust me, only got a few. I put them up near the front door. These are gifts that you can buy. A lot of people use them for birthday gifts or around Christmas. They are gifts that help people. I'll let you look through it, but you could buy things such as a housewarming kit for someone who's being homeless and they just moved into their home. You can buy an olive tree to be planted in Palestine. There's all sorts of things here. It's good to look at. Marty.
And that's online as well.
Good.
You can do the shopping online with it. Right?
And raising funds for the grandmothers, two grandmothers campaign in Africa, which is to help the grandmothers who are raising the children of the village because of the AIDS epidemic, which has taken over their parents, has caused their parents to die. Anyway, the two fundraisers coming up, sorry, this is late when anyway, on Monday night, tomorrow night, we have a fundraiser at Boston Pizza, where our group is given 10% of proceeds from 5 o'clock until 8 o'clock. And all you have to do is go and enjoy a meal, and then the 4th of November is our sale at Lost Church in Cambridge, and it's from 9 until 1.
It's great. There's lots of opportunities there if you need, want to feel so moved to reach out and give and help. That being all the announcements, Sophie, would you like to light our Christ candle? We light our Christ candle to symbolize Christ's presence with us now and always. As Sophie's doing that, I'm going to say, Christ be with you.
I'm also with you.
I'm
to our community of faith.
We are united by our love of Christ.
Friends, let us worship. Let us pray. Loving God, thank you for everyone who worships here today and for all the people who want to be with us but can't. Lord, your presence is what empowers us to do good in the world. We are thankful for your presence with us this day. Open our hearts and minds to your word. Amen. In our prayer of confession, I will say the prayer of confession today, and in there will be a point where it says silent reflection, where we can just sit in silence and make our own personal confessions to God. God, may I know your love and mercy as much as you know my mistakes. You know when I have failed to be loving. You know when I have failed to follow you. Only you can ease the pain of my guilt. Lord, be with those I have hurt. Strengthen my relationship with you. Make me a part of your healing work. Keep me from the things that keep me from you. And our words of assurance come from Sharon Alder. You are not what others think you are. You are what God knows you are. Thanks be to God. Let's join in singing, O God, how we have wandered.
Well, we actually need four more men. And I will tell you like teaching you to say,
right.
Speak for your servant is listening.
I have an important job for you to do, Samuel.
What is it, Lord? I can't wait to begin.
King Saul has disobeyed me, so I want you to choose a new king for me. Go see Jesse in Bethlehem and choose me a king from among his sons.
But Lord, if Saul hears of this, he will kill me.
Must I hit them? Take along a heifer for sacrifice, and don't forget to take a horn of anointing oil.
Yes, Lord, your servant hears and obeys.
Written by David. and put a new and loyal spirit in me. Do not banish me from your presence. Do not take your Holy Spirit away from me. Give me again the joy that comes from your salvation, and make me willing to obey you. Then I will teach sinners your commandments, and they will turn back to you.
So, for the anthem, we wanted to do From a Distance by Bette Midler, and we thought we'd do some, we found a really great video that sort of helps to capture the whole spirit of the video, and it's a really nice song. So, the words are on the screen, if you remember the song by Bette Midler, and there's some nice inspirational quotes from Helen Keller and others there. So, feel free to sing along, and the choir is going to sing too.
little piece of Play-Doh and just say, create something, and they will. They see what this can become, like little artists, little sculptors. God shapes the world like a sculptor shapes stone. From the bottom of the Grand Canyon to the top of Mount Everest, all the way up to the stars in the sky, God's artwork is here for everyone to see. Even us, small, tiny humans in a huge, immense universe, we are something wonderful, wonderfully made. And God didn't just create us to stand back and watch what happens. God creates and calls us and then waits for our response. God is waiting for us to say yes, yes to God, so that God can work in our lives and shape them like an artist creating a masterpiece. That we are free to respond to God's call in any way that we choose. We can ignore God, we can reject God, or we can say yes to God and allow God to shape us and make us something wonderful. The famous Italian sculptor Michelangelo said, in every block of stone, there is a statue inside it, and it is the task of the sculptor to discover it. I think God sees us like this, like a work of art. God sees beyond our outward appearances into our hearts and our souls. And God is ready to shape us if we only say yes. Now, God saw the potential in the Hebrew people, the potential for greatness. And God worked to mold them into a nation, saying, I will be your God, and you will be my people. But before they came together as a nation, they were just a group of disparate, separate, loosely connected tribes. And they were constantly under attack from their neighbors. They really couldn't defend themselves because they were separate and small. And they longed for a king to come and unite them and protect them. Give us a king, they said. And God warned them that maybe this wasn't such a good idea. If you have a king, God said, he will take your sons and your daughters and the best of your fields, and you will be his slaves. But the people begged God for a king, so God agreed to give them one. And the first king of Israel was King Saul. Now Saul started off as a really good king. God's spirit was with Saul, and Saul did good things for the people. He united the tribes. He created a kingdom that was prosperous, that could defend itself. And things went well for a long time, until Saul stopped listening to God. And Saul became more interested in his own interests, and then started dabbling in worship of other things and other religious practices that weren't, they were belonged to the people in the area, but not to the Hebrew God. So God's spirit left Saul. And then there was a need for to select a new king. And that's what we saw in our skit. When Saul was no longer a good king, so David was chosen to be the king. And God's spirit is now with David. David says yes to God, and David becomes a really good king. But before he becomes king, he does many amazing things. He fights a giant called Goliath. And when you look at this statue, this famous statue of King David, this shows David at the moment he's prepared for battle. So he hasn't yet fought the giant. He's got his slingshot slung over his shoulder and a look of determination in his eyes, and he's ready to face Goliath. God's spirit is with him, and he knows he can win. Now, this statue of King David stands 16 feet tall. It's beautiful. It's considered to be one of the most beautiful works of art in the world. It's amazing, and many people are very moved when they see it. We know it as being sculpted by Michelangelo, but he wasn't the only sculptor that worked on it. There were three. The first sculptor who was hired to create this statue has been the stone. I can't work with this marble. And he quit. So then the marble sat there for maybe 10 years. It was a big chunk of expensive marble that we moved from a quarry to Florence. And people said, you know, we have to use this. So they hired another sculptor. And he started to work, and he started to sort of rough out a shape. But then he too said, there's too many imperfections in this marble. I can't work with it. So it sat there for another 26 years. Until Michelangelo came along. And Michelangelo said, I can work with this. Yeah, there's imperfections in this marble, but I can create something beautiful. I can bring the image of David out in this stone. And that's what he did. I think that's what God does with us. I think God looks at us and says, I can work with these people. They're not perfect. They have flaws. They have imperfections. But I can make them something wonderful. Now, David, when David was first chosen to be king, was a wonderful, wonderful warrior and wonderful king. But he had flaws. He wasn't perfect. There was a time that came where he too started to think about his own interests rather than that of other people. And that was when he saw Bathsheba. This is the subject of the famous Leonard Cohen song, Hallelujah. David sees Bathsheba bathing on the roof, and he sleeps with her. Now, when I was researching this, there are scholars that made the comment, they don't know if this was consensual. But we don't know because of the times. Women didn't have a lot of choice. But I can't make any assumptions. But in any case, it was wrong because Bathsheba was married to one of David's soldiers who was off fighting the war for his king. So this was really wrong. He slept with Bathsheba, Bathsheba became pregnant, and now David's worried, I'm going to be found out. So he devises a plan to bring her husband back from the war, and so that he won't be good. David won't get blamed for the pregnancy. But this doesn't work out, and he realizes the only solution that he, well, the solution he finds, the one he chooses, is to have her husband killed. So he sends Bathsheba's husband off to the worst war zone, where he will most definitely be killed, and that's what happens. So basically, it's kind of, it's murder. It's signs of death warrant. So David is no longer a good king. He doesn't quite realize this at first until a prophet comes and speaks to him and said, you know, David, I'm going to tell you a little story about someone who had loads of cattle and was very rich and stole the land from someone who was very poor. And David listened and said, that person's awful. And Nathan says, no, that person is you. This story opened up David's mind. He realized that what he'd done was really bad. And he repents. Once he repents, God knows that God can work in him. If he hadn't repented, I think it would have gone like Saul. Like, I can no longer work with this king who is rejecting me and going his own way. But David repents, and David goes on. He continues to be a really good king. He's known as the greatest king in Israel, in Israel's history. And I think, when I think of this story, I think of the forgiveness that God had for David. And I'm grateful that God shows this kind of forgiveness, that God can look at us like we are an imperfect piece of stone, and yet work around our flaws and make us something beautiful. When I look at other people, and I think many of us fall into this trap, sometimes all I see are their flaws. And I think, oh, I don't know about this person. When I'm looking at a street kid who's holding up a sign that says, I'm broke, I'm hungry, I think, they're just going to spend the money on drugs. Or when I hear about someone like Harvey Weinstein who's being so reviled and in the media, and I think, what a horrible, horrible person. But then I think, he too needs forgiveness on some level. What do we do with the people that are broken and flawed? Because we can't just toss them away. They're with us. And one of the things that I think God invites us to do is to look within and see that little spark of potential, that spark of beauty, that worthiness that we can work with. I get this from Jesus. When Jesus, who are the people that Jesus spends time with and works with and approaches? They're the people who are on the margins, the people who are obviously flawed and rejected by society. So I think God calls us to look at other people and see their potential, see beyond their flaws, see the beauty of their soul that is within. Not easy to do, but that's why we want a connection with God. I think when we work on our relationship with God, it makes us more like God, right? Without my connection to God, without my faith, I don't think forgiveness would be as possible. And I don't want to hold up forgiveness as kind of an idol in this case and saying that everybody should forgive absolutely everything. There are things we can't, as humans, we can't forgive. We just don't have the potential to forgive. But in those instances, I am even more grateful that we have a God that forgives us. Because that gives us second chances. It makes us feel worthy and loved, and it takes away the shame that the world puts on us at different times. So, to me, King David isn't an inspiration because he was a handsome warrior or he was talented at so many things, a great king. King David is an inspiration because he was a great man who could say, I was wrong. Forgive me. Give me another chance. I think that's something I hope for all of us. God loves us, forgives us, and sees how we are worthy. Thanks be to God.
No.
give as you are so moved. Give in a spirit of gratitude. Give what you are able. Give knowing that you deeply appreciate. Lord, be with the people in our faith community who are in hospital, the people who are ill, the people who are facing struggles that we are unaware of. Help us to be a loving, giving community of faith that reaches out to one another. Lord, in the spirit of Christ, we sing our prayer to you, the prayer that Jesus taught. We'll be doing an antiphonal prayer. Is it so we sing, antiphonal means that we sing back with your chocolate bowl. Wonderful.